Throw down. So drop the top, baby. And let's cruise on into this better than ever street.
High School. I'm George Hammel, head football coach of the Brookside Cardinals football family. Today we're going to present to you our offensive scheme, the boot and shoot offense. Now today, tape and time do not allow us to get into all of our offensive playbook, but to give you the basics for the boot and shoot, we're going to present to you running plays and our passing plays. We think that you'll find all of these to your liking, and we hope that you'll be able to use some, if not all, of our ideas. If you are interested in our complete detailed playbook, please write me at the address included at the front of the video. Send a check for $12 made out to the Brookside coaches, and I will send you our bound, very detailed playbook. You've just seen two of our top plays and some of our running and passing plays that we like to use in the boot and shoot. Later in this presentation, you'll see those diagrams on the board for you. Before we get to the real X and O's, please allow me a moment to just give you a brief history of what we've had to overcome at Brookside High School. When I arrived here 4 years ago, one of the newspaper reporters asked me how I was going to turn around the worst program in the state of Ohio. Well, that made me smile a little bit, and I just told him I was going to dig out my magic wand, wave it a couple times, and everything would be okay. Really, I don't think our program was that bad, but it surely was down and out, and it was in the dumps. We knew we had to come in here and do something to motivate the young men to once again believe they could win. We're proud to tell you that in the last 2 years, we believe our program has turned the corner and we're taking large strides, becoming a very respected football team here in Northern Ohio. Now, 2 years ago, we finished second in the conference at the number one defense. We had the first winning team since 1967. If you can imagine, since LBJ was in the White House, this football program has not had a winning season. We ended that a year ago. This year, we're proud to say, that we have the first back-to-back winning seasons since 1966 and 67. So we're very proud of what we've accomplished. We believe that we're on the road to long success. And we feel that most importantly, you must play defense. Your defense is going to allow you to be in a position to win football games. Then your offense has got to score enough points and keep the opponent's offense off the field. We're very happy to report that this year we controlled the ball. Time of it was in our advantage, almost 2-1 for the 91 football season. We feel that gives us a great advantage over our opponents, and it puts us in a better position to win a football game. We shortened the game to our advantage. We like that. We like when our defense does not spend the entire night on the field. Not in all games did that come true, but for the most part, it was a large reason for our success. Now, not only is it tough trying to rebuild a down-and-out program, but we also play in a very competitive conference. In the last 3 years, there have been 9 representatives from our conference in the state playoffs in Ohio. That is not very easy to do. The playoffs here are very difficult to make. There are 38 teams in our region alone, and in that region only 4 make it. Every year we have 10-0 football teams, some very good 9-1s that don't make the playoffs. We have some darn good 7-3 football teams that don't make the playoffs. So it's very difficult here in Ohio. We think that we play in a very tough conference, and we have that many representatives the last 3 years that you're playing against quality teams. Now, our football program has to overcome a tough schedule, non-conference and conference. We have to overcome those non-conference foes, as I said, and our conference foes. We have to overcome a lot of losing tradition. We felt we've taken many steps in the last 4 years, especially the last 2. And there are a lot of reasons for that turnaround. Most importantly, our young men have developed a good work ethic. They've developed a great family attitude. We talk all the time about our family, our football family. We believe very strongly in that concept. It's allowed us to become successful. Our boys are not overly large. We don't have a lot of monsters of the midway waiting around for us. We do have a lot of average and sometimes below average kids that work hard. They've developed the last 4 years a good work ethic. They get in the weight room. They're scrappy. They're tough kids. And with that dedication, and now the most important ingredient, they finally believe they can win. When they take the field on Friday night, they believe they're going to win the football game. And that attitude, as most of you experienced coaches know, is the key ingredient to winning programs. Now, when we get them to execute, when we get them to carry out the game plan, do so with great desire, it just increases our chances of winning on a Friday night. Our offense is really, we believe, in the final chapter of our offensive book. By that I mean that we originally, many years ago, were wing T. We feel that's our roots. The wing T, the Delaware wing T, is very flexible and has allowed us to build into it over the years the run and shoot, which we used a great deal in the late 80s. We then began, as we entered the 90s, experimenting and using the veer, and you may have purchased our veer and shoot. We thought that was very good. We just felt it wasn't enough, and we wanted to develop a more complete package. And now we're very happy to report to you we have a good marriage between our offenses. We feel in our offensive package that between the Delaware wing tee and the run and shoot, we have all the tools we need to be successful on a Friday night offensively. It's been very good to us. The past year, in 1991, our last 2 years, our quarterback has thrown for over 2,500 yards. He's a legitimate Division I, maybe 1AA prospect, right now being highly recruited by the University of Pittsburgh. And we feel that he has an excellent chance to garnish a good scholarship. A year ago, we had a running back for over 1,000 yards. We have this year three running backs. And really, this year, more than any, made the Delaware aspect of a four-back offense come true with our quarterback throwing for so many yards. And then we had three backs, each who rushed for over 60 attempts, each of who had over a 5.1 rushing average. And as I said earlier, we controlled the ball almost 2-1 to our opponents. We had twice as many first downs as our opponents. And we feel that we have an awfully strong offensive punch. We now feel as if our evolution is near complete. We, like you out there, are always looking to try and improve, to get better at what we do, but we're very happy, probably the happiest we've been in a long time. We feel we have a complete package that will allow us to compete successfully, offensively, on Friday night. Before we get into the playbook itself and some of the important aspects we want to share with you today, I would like to give credit to the following coaches. They played an important role in my life, and I, like most of you, are really an accumulation of all the coaches who touched my life. And there have been several key coaches I'd like to give credit to at this time. My wing T gurus, my Delaware wing T gurus, Joe Buffalino does a great job in Pennsylvania. Vern Long here in Northern Ohio, an older veteran coach, does a great job, and it's really been someone I hear that I can bounce ideas off of. My run and shoot guru, Tony Legando, probably the purest run and shoot team I've ever known, and they do a great job with it. Bill Jones, another Northern Ohio coach who has given me an awful lot. And Dave Grack, Pennsylvania coach. Dave was on my staff when I coached in Pennsylvania. We've remained good friends over 20 years. He was with us in our championship years down there. He's always been there for me to bounce ideas off and been giving me good advice over the years, might I add. Just a super coach, super guy. And I really like to give them credit. And also Don Anderson, who all of those men have played an important role in my life, and I'd like to thank them at this time. All right, the first thing that we want to share with you in our boot and shoot offense is how do we call plays? Well, we use a three-digit system here at Brookside. We feel is a very quick and effective method of communicating with our young men what we want called is our formation. The second digit is the series that we use, and the third digit is the point of attack. If there is a name after it, and it's a running play, it is a blocking scheme we would like to use. An example of that would be 435G. 435G. 400 formation, 30 series at the 5 hole. G blocking. I might add here that the blocking call can be changed at the line by the lineman. They have a number of blocking calls they work on. Our line coach, Coach Abel, does a tremendous job each week giving the offensive line different looks, how to adjust at the line with different line calls. And those line calls, by the way, are in our playbook. The formation can be changed, altered. Motion, all would come before the numbers. If it was a passing alteration, that would come at the end. And so we have a very effective way of calling plays. Now, how do we set everything in motion? How do we get everything going? The cadence. They're very simple, again, very effective cadence. It is set, then number, then hit. An example, if we were going on two, would be set, 21, 21. That is how a quarterback would call the cadence at the line of scrimmage. Now, motion, adjustment to formations all come on the first number. Now, those numbers play an important role in our audible game. When we want to change plays at the line of scrimmage, or we want to run the no huddle, we can use those numbers as live. Now, It also is a way, once we change formations, to snap the ball quickly while we can have the defense outflanked. Our formations. In our formations, 100 through 900, the tight end always goes to the number. So if it was 100, it is to the left. And might I add here that the formations, all of the odd numbered formations, 100, 3, 5, 900, all of those formations are to the tight end is to the left. If it was an even number such as 2, 4, 6, or 8, they are to the right. The tight end is to the right. The split ends rule is just the opposite. He aligns away from the number. The split end aligns opposite the number in our base formations. Now, probably you're asking yourself, well, coach, you have all these formations. Which ones do you like to use in the boot and shoot? Well, when we're in our boot and shoot mode, we like to use the 300 to 400, 500, 600, and 900 formations. And those are the ones we're going to concentrate primarily on today. We want to give it more of a wing T, a Delroy wing T look. We're in our 1-200. We want to be in a double tight, double split end, 800 alignment. If we want to power the football, we'll go into our T. By the way, we do have a few word formations. Example, T. Also trips right, trips left as examples. And we feel that it's an easy way to communicate to the tight ends, but how to line up? By going to the number away from the number in the base formations. All right, as you're looking at these formations that we're going to put up on the board for you here in just a moment, please. Also on the board, our whole numbering, how we number each offensive lineman, to the right 2, 4, 6, 8, to the left 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Now, also how we align in the boot and shoot formations. Remember this, that 400 is a mirror of 300, as 500 is a mirror of 600. Now, what we'd like to cover this time is how we shift formations. And a very important and integral part of our package is to be able to shift our formations. We think that combining this with a quick cadence, just prior to the snap of the football, moving the formation, we have the possibility of 1, outflanking the defense, 2, catching them moving with us and out of position. Also, they're thinking, where do we go? How do we align? Who do I have now? And 3rd, if they don't move, we get them outflanked. And also, we found lately that we have been getting teams to play a lot of vanilla defense against us because we do a lot of moving. I must admit we did more of this at the beginning and the end of the year than we did in the middle. That was primarily because of personnel and we had some injuries. We do like to do a lot of changing of formation. Show you one thing, move quickly to another, and then snap the football. Now, what I'm going to do is talk you through each one of these that we have, show them to you on the board, and then show live game footage of us shifting the formation just prior to the snap of the ball. The first one I'd like to talk to you about is what we call move to. An example of this would be move to 3-34-G. Now, it affects the halfbacks. We have a left halfback and a right halfback. If you could have a left half, you could have a halfback and a wingback if you wanted to. They align opposite the call when they come to the line of scrimmage. So it looks like we're going to be strong left almost because we'll have two backs over there with a tight end. When the quarterback says his first number, all the players involved, the two halves, will move to where they should be in 300 and then we'll snap the football. So they come out of the huddle, they would align to the left, and then they would move to the right at the first number, and then we snap the ball. So it really is very quick, and then if there's motion off the play, for an example, we might go move to 337 down G, where we get the backs left, then we bring one of the backs coming back in motion, and we'll run the belly dive play over there. So there's a lot of things we can do with that. Now, and again, after we talk you through each of these, we will be showing them to you on the board, and we also will be showing you live game footage. Next way that we change formation, slide to, one of our favorites. This involves the halfbacks and the tight end. For the halfbacks, it is the same rule as move to. Align opposite the formation called in the huddle, and then now slide to that formation call. The tight end is now involved. He, for example, will line opposite and then move to the call, or slide to the call that was made in the huddle. So we could have slide to 3-34-G. We could slide to 2-36 down G as another example. So slide to involves the tight end and the halfbacks. They align opposite and then they slide on that first number to where they should be for the formation call. Our next way that we will change the formation quickly is something we call hop to. Here, both halfbacks align in wingback positions, like 5-600. Then, on the first number, quarterback calls, they hop to the called formation. An example, hop to 3-34-G. The last one we have for you is jump to. In jump two, the halfbacks align in the T backfield, and on this quarterback's first sound, they will jump to the formation call. Jump to 334G. We feel that by changing formations this way, it gives us a distinct advantage over our opponents. Now, the method we've used, we think, is simple. Our kids adapted to it quickly. We also have ways to just move the tight end by himself, the split end by himself, and all of those are in our playbook that we talked about earlier. Let me just show you that at this time while I have it with me right here. This is our playbook. You can see it has a nice binding to it. It's rather thick. There are probably 80 or so pages in here. Everything is detailed for you. Plays, everyone's assignment, objectives, terminologies, everything you would want is in here. A very detailed format of our package. Yours for only the cost of the printing and shipping of $12. And again, if you're interested in our playbook, please write to us. Send a check in care of myself or the Brookside coaching staff and mail it to the address that was included in the first part of this video. All right, let's look at those moves, jumps, slides, and hops that we just talked about, the way we change formations quickly. Let's see those on the board and then in live game footage.
Let me tell you about a place somewhere up in New York way, where the people are so gay, twisting the night away. Here they have a lot of fun, putting trouble on the run. Man, you find the old and young, twisting the night away. Yeah, twisting, twisting, everybody's feeling great. They're twisting, twisting, they're twisting the night away. Hear the man in evening clothes, how he got here I don't know. Man, you ought to see him go, twisting the night away. He's dancing with the chicken slacks, she's moving up and back. Oh man, there ain't nothing like twisting the night away. They're twisting, twisting, everybody's feeling great. They're twisting, twisting, they're twisting the night. Let's twist a while. With the older queen who's dolled up in her diamond rings and twisting the night away. Man, you ought to see her go, twisting to the rock and roll. Here you find the young and old, twisting the night away. They're twisting, twisting, man, everybody's feeling great. They're twisting, twisting, twisting the night one more time. There's a new thing that's going around, and I'll tell you what to put.
loop-de-loop. Put your hands on your hips and kind of let your backbone slip. Move your body like a whip and just shake. That's doing it. Shake. Yeah, you're looking good now. Shake. Shake the shake with all your might. Or if you do it right. Just make your body loose tonight. You gotta shake.
Tight end exchanges positions. When we have him opposite where he belongs and then he slides to, the split end must be off the line of scrimmage or he's covering the tight end. That is illegal. And once the tight end, when the tight end leaves, the split end will step on the line of scrimmage, making him a legal receiver as well, an illegal formation. All right, there are a few other ways that we will modify our formations, and I'd like to just go over these with you at this time. The first one is when we use the word split. An example, we would say split 334G. Here, the split end simply reduces his split from a normal 15-17 yard alignment to 4-6 yards alignment. Oftentimes, we'll use the split when we want to either run that side and get it, we have a good split who can block and get him moved in where we can block. We use it to keep the defense in balance. They can't roll over the secondary or shift linebackers maybe to a tight end side. If we're in a 1-2 hundred, we oftentimes run a split 1-2 hundred formation and then run the ball back to the tight end. Keeps the defense very balanced. It's almost like having two tight ends in the game. And it's been very effective for us. The other one is tight. If we want to get them real in close tight, we usually bring two tight ends when we do this, and we'll go tight 200, tight 600. We have a double tight end formation. We usually bring two tight ends if we want to do that. The one we use an awful lot is over. Here the split end will align opposite of his normal alignment. If you go back into our formations and pick out, say, for an example, 100 or 200, we oftentimes would like an over 218 power. It's a power sweep. We're an unbalanced formation. It gives us an extra blocker on that side. And it's been a very good play for us, very good formation. We go over. Obviously, we have the passing plays and those other items that come off of that as well. Next one is flank. Here, the halfback to the formation, in other words, like flank 500, the left halfback, would align as a flanker. Often here, we do use another split end, and because he's more adept at running pass routes. We use this an awful lot when we pass. We also run from this as well. Wide. Here, the halfback to the field will align in a wide slot, almost 10 yards, 12 yard alignment from his normal 6. An example of this would be 562. Now, the slot would widen out to the right hand side, put the tight end to the boundary. This allows us to run a hot play you'll see a little later coming up when we do the run and shoot plays. Now, how do we motion in the boot and shoot? Well, the first motion involves the halfbacks. We have rip. Here, the left halfback goes across the formation to the right, or Liz, where the right halfback goes across the formation to his left. If we want to motion the halfbacks to their side where they do not cross the formation, jet is the term the left halfback uses. He goes in motion to his left. Fly is the right halfback's motion term to his right. We also can motion the fullback and go no back if we wish to. Do some in 5 and 600. And for roar, the fullback goes to his right. And for lion, the fullback goes to his left. That is the motion that we use with the backs. We also have len and ren for the split end. In len, the split end goes from to the left, and the halfback to his side steps up to give us a legal formation. If we're going to get double coverage on our best receiver, a lot of times we'll let him ren him. Ren, he goes to the right, the left halfback steps up on a line of scrimmage, and the split end will motion to the right. And often we can get him one-on-one coverage this way. Now, what I'd like to do is show for you on the board the running plays we like to use in the 3 and 400 formations. We'll put a list of these plays up on the board. We'll go over them on the board. We'll show you a diagram of them. And then we'll, at the end of this, we'll put in plays from the 3-400 formations on film. So we'll see it on the board, and then there'll be live game film footage following this. So we're not going to have the time to show you 400 because it is a mirror image, but we will show you 300 running plays and 400 running plays in live game formations, 300 plays on the board. Let's look at those plays on the board at this time.
Me, I want to know, how can I tell if you love me so?
Is it in his eyes?
Oh no, you'll be deceived.
Is it in his eyes?
Oh no, you'll make believe if you want to know. If he loves you so, it's in his kiss.
That's where it is. Oh yeah, or is it in his face?
Oh no, it's just his charm.
The 323 play that you've just seen here, 323 trap, is one of the better plays for us. It's really a little counter play. It comes off the Buck series and the wing T, and we set it up a lot with 2021, as you can well imagine. Also, our waggle play will come off of a play that's very similar to this, and it is a very good play for us. I think if you use it, it can be very effective for you in any offense that you have two backs in the backfield. Oftentimes, because where you pass the football, you'll see the secondary rotated over to our split end slot side, and we'll come back with a trap to the tight end. And you know, sometimes I put him in the boundary, it's a good play to the boundary, and we get a back out here, and we sprung this for a couple touchdowns this year. A nice play for us. All right, next, let's look at the 30 series out of the 300. We'll draw a few of those up on the board for you. At the 34 plate, you're going to see here at 3 and 400, 334G and 435G are ice, are all excellent and are out, 334 out, 334 ice. Great football play for us. It has been, the belly play has been a great play for us this year. Later on, you've seen the game footage, live footage, that we will take the football up and down the field using this play. It's a great 3-5 yard play. We busted it for touchdowns. It is a great play for us. If you saw the Sugar Bowl at all, this is the one play that Notre Dame Pettis ran and busted it up for a big touchdown. And obviously, we get a block point of attack. We do pretty good with this. It's a great play. I think you'll like it. Let's take a good look at this now.
Rescue me. I want your tender charm, 'cause I'm lonely.
just on the board. It's something we got came upon at the end of last year. We got to use it in the last couple of ball games. It was really good for us. Because the way we throw the football, as well as run the ball, teams went to try and put a tackle inside to stop the trap play, and the end outside for contain rush, and they could have a backer or a safety, something out here, trying to get in the pass coverage. And this went real well against that type of front and coverage. This play has been a great football play for us. We really got a lot of mileage out of it. We love the football play. I think you will too. It was a counter to us as a blocking scheme with a backside tackle pulls. In this case, the right tackle to trap the first thing past the center. In this case, we got a three technique tackle here. We're going to try to trap him. Off taps, he comes up field, and that block isn't made in the line, gives the back even more run to room up in there. A lot of times we get a double on this backer as the quarterback rolls out, reverses out, which makes it look like about, you got the belly play going, 34, 32.
You believe in love, because I got something to say about it, and it goes something like this. Don't go false, second best, baby, put your love to the test. You know, you got to make him express how it feels, and baby, then you know. Thank you.
for a change. You may get disgusted.
Okay, what we'd like to do at this time is show you some of the plays we run out of 500 and 600 formations. We're drawing 600 on the board. Remember that the 500 formation is just the opposite. Now, all the plays that you've just seen in the 300 and 400 can be used in 5-6. But these plays, particularly, we like to use 5-6 if we're in the boot and shoot package. Again, after you see them on the board, we will be showing you some live footage. Now let's take a look at 6-16 down.
Thank you.
Okay, coaches, what we'd like to do at this time is discuss our passing game, the waggle and the shoot part of it. And I think you're going to find this exciting. I think you're going to find things here that you can use. All of us seem to be running the waggle, what many of you may call the bootleg. And we think we've got some interesting ways to run this. We think there's some very good, effective ways. And also our running shoot play, plus of all the options that come off of these. What I'd like to do at this time is go over the rules for the waggle play. The first thing we do is teach the young men the rules. Once they learn the rules, no matter what formation they're in, they follow their rules, and they will execute a good play. First, the receiver rules. The front side number one receiver is responsible to run a flag to an out route. Try to get inside position, sell the post, break it back to the flag. If the flag is not there, bend it off on a deep out, basically 17 to 15 yards. The number two receiver to the front side, if we have one, such as in the 300 formation, is to run a seam route. He is to go as deep as possible, draw the safety or the corner with him to open up the flag. If they bite on the flag and we happen to get, and we like to do this in two deep especially, we have two on one, then we have one of the two is obviously open. Number one receiver backside runs a post or a dig route. And again, we number from the outside end for our receivers. The number two receiver to the backside or the tight end slot. He doesn't have anybody out flanking him. He still has a number two receiver in. He runs the drag route at 10 to 12 yards. Find a bubble, settle down in it, get your numbers to the quarterback, and the drag oftentimes becomes our number one receiver. As you'll see in this live game action video that will follow this. Our back rules. The halfback in 300 takes a counter step. He is going to come across, make a great fake over the ball. He then is responsible after two steps to block the first defender that shows. Basically, we're looking for a backside end, a linebacker, corner blitz, something of that nature. Protect the quarterback's backside. But most importantly, sell the run first. And the play we're going to see today, we run off of 28-29. We're going to draw a lot of 29 up for you out of our 300 formation. The nice thing also, coaches, in the rules is that we can do this out of any formation, any play, once they learn the rules, as I said earlier. You will see we have one shot, I believe, where one of our adjustments to our formation, we get into an I formation, and we run an, basically call it an I 28, excuse me, I 219, 119, excuse me, coaches, I 119 waggle. It looks like the basic eye pitch, and we waggle back away from it. And so the waggle rules hold true for almost anything we want to run the waggle out of. The fullback is supposed to attack the front side A-gap. He is to fake past the quarterback. The quarterback will not extend a hand or a ball. It's just going to go by him. But make a big fake over the ball, protect A-gap. If nothing shows, he is to try to get down the boundary, or down the line of scrimmage to the boundary as he begins approaching 5-6 yards, throttled down, but he is more or less a safety receiver. This year, in a video you'll see of this year, not many of our fullbacks were able to get out for one basic reason. We changed the rule this year, told them they weren't allowed to go out. I don't think our receivers, our fullbacks, could catch the football if life, limb, family, and everything was on the line. They just did not have a good set of hands for catching, but they were very good running and blocking backs. The quarterback, most important. He's open to the midline, but his butt to the hole, 29 in this case. Then go back to the halfback. Extend, put the ball in your left hand, cradle it in your stomach. Extend your right hand into the halfback's belly. Let your right arm go with him. Then your eyes will follow, and as you leave him, as he begins to separate from you, whip your head back around in this fashion to find out what's happening to your front side. Was everybody blocked? Did everybody buy the fake? Are you safe to roll out? In our base play,
We tell the quarterback, get width and depth and read deep to short. If no one is open, the quarterback will yell go. His personal protector, the guards, will then escort him downfield. We have a couple shots of that for you. Line rules. Front side tackle, backside tackle, block base. Our base rule is in, on, out, linebacker. Front side guard pulls and tries to log or hook front side number three defender. The center, if he's covered, blocks base. If he's uncovered, block back. The backside guard will pull, get a depth step, read what the front side guard is doing. If he needs help, help him secure that man. If not, continue on and secure the next threat and become the quarterback's personal protector. If there is no next threat, turn back and look for pursuit and take care of it. All right, what I'd like to do for you now at this time is to put up on the board for you a couple of our favorite waggle plays and different formations, show you how they work, and then put up some of our adjustments to waggle. And I think you'll really like the adjustments you'll see in waggle. After you see those on the board, coaches, we're going to have some live game footage of the waggle play. I'll tell you, it has been one of the greatest plays for us. We've loved this play forever. We really work at it. We're going to get better at it still, we think. We just love this football play. We'll run it sometimes four times in a row. We love this play. We've run it more than that sometimes, it seems. It's been a great play for us, and I think from the game footage you'll see what I mean. All right, now this time, let's look at 329 waggle on the board and other base waggle plays and then some of the adjustments. And as I said earlier, we'll go to some game footage after that. This time, coaches, to show you some adjustments we have on the basic play. First one we have on the board here is 129 waggle at 7. Now, by that we mean at 7, it tells our backside guard he's going to kick out now. Quarterback's going to pull up at 7 yards depth behind the front side tackle, and he's primarily looking for the tight end or the wing back here who's going to be going down the middle or running the dig route. Now, everything else stays the same, all the rules stay the same. He can, if the split end's wide open, throw to him, obviously. But it is a way, if we get a lot of outside pressure, we can kick it out, and now we can pull up and hit two of these guys coming across. It's been a good play. All right, after that, we're now going to show you called waggle keep. We're not going to draw that up on the board for you, but waggle keep is 329 keep, and we're just telling a quarterback to basically bootleg the ball, keep the ball, and go. You know, the guard's going to go with him, he sells keep, he gets out there, pump fakes, pass, and it's pump, 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 go. It's an automatic call. We've seen some on the sideline, we think it's wide open, and we tell him to go with it. Alright, the next play we will draw for you is our waggle screen. So now we'll draw 329 waggle screen.
Complete. When you walk out on the street,
Good morning, coaches. Welcome back. This morning we're going to do the second part of this video, and we're going to concentrate on our 60 series. That is the gangster play and the run and shoot offense. We name it 62 to the right and 63 to the left. We're going to display it for you on the board out of our base formations in the boot and shoot, which would be 3, 400, 5, 6, and our 900 series, our formations, excuse me. And then we will present you some of the change-ups that we make in that run-and-shoot package or adjustments in the 60 game with routes and different receivers. I think you're going to like what you see. This has been one of the greatest plays for us. As I mentioned earlier, yesterday, the Waggle and the 60 series have been tremendous, tremendous plays for us. They've allowed our quarterback to have our receivers to have great success. They've allowed us to be able to throw on first down or fourth down or anywhere in between. They've been plays you can use in the clutch. They have been plays we can game plan and come out and do with. They've allowed us to dictate tempo often and mix with a good running attack. This has allowed us, as I mentioned earlier, to maintain the football and to keep a shorten the game, keep our defense off the field, and it has allowed us to have success the last few years. Again, the gangster play or the 60 series for us. The first thing I would like to do with you is go over our receiver rules, and this is how we teach it to the players. Once they learn the rules, then they, wherever they line up by formation, they can run the play. So the first thing we do is teach receiver rules. Now the front side number one receiver, which is usually the split end, and always is the split end, excuse me, he is going to run the gangster route, what we call the gangster route, and Tiger Ellison's gangster route of the 1960s hasn't changed for us. This is basically what many of you might call a little curl. Our receiver is going to try to get 7 yards depth and come back to two on a, little curl route, and you'll see that in the film. After all of these are presented to you on the board in a few moments, I'm going to then take live game footage and follow up so you can see the 60 series in live action. The number two front side receiver, he has the what we term the hot route. In reality, he is running a basketball pick route. And I will never admit to that, other than on his tape probably, but we call it a hot route. We don't even tell our players they're running a pick route. But we talk a lot about being a basketball player. You want to box out the linebacker to your side, or the number first inside linebacker, excuse me, to your side. And we'll show that on the board in just a moment. The back, the remaining back, or splitting if we were in a trip situation, is going to run the bubble route. Some people call it a bubble route. Well, we call it the bubble route. Some people I've heard call it the swing route, the stretch route. It's the one he's going to be moving parallel line of scrimmage to the boundary, and it's a very critical route. It must be worked. A lot of time goes into this. We used to, when we first started this, like everybody else, and back take that big ball and try to come up the line of scrimmage. We found out that the quarterback never knows quite where that receiver is going to be, and the timing just wasn't there. We just have him go straight down the line, turn his shoulders and head back to the quarterback, and it's worked well for us. The back's rules now. The fullback is responsible to block front side number three. And we do an awful lot, I'll tell you this right now, we do an awful lot of counting work. We want them to count the games to the point actually to come up and go 1, 2, 3. Well, we don't mind if they do that, just 1, 2, 3 when you come up, or mentally. Just look at them and count your eyes, 1, 2, and 3. And then you know you're blocking. Use the attack line of scrimmage to get to the outside hip of the front side number three. Now, we don't always get the block we want. This is the one area that we have dedicated to improve on for next year, as our fullback has to attack more line of scrimmage. Now, I mentioned earlier the remaining halfback has the stretch route or the bubble route. Quarterback. The quarterback has a semi-roll. He's going to be going to the call side. 62 being an even number would be to the right. 63 being an odd number would be to the left. Quarterback would have a semi-roll, and he is to get going to the right. We want the ball thrown by the fifth step. He's going to the left on any 63, we want the ball thrown by the sixth step. Now, we try to get it timed up by on the quarterback steps due to the pass blocking and the nature of the play. And we feel we can get the ball off on the fifth or sixth step, depending on which way we're going, that it's almost virtually impossible for the quarterback to be sacked if he makes the right read. Now, who is the quarterback reading? Well, when the quarterback comes up the line of scrimmage, we're going to have him scan left to right with his eyes. He is going to, once he goes across the formation, he'll then find number four, get his number. He'll then turn around and like to have him check his players and get his eyes refocused on front side number four. He already knows who he is. From the time he calls his cadence and gets the snap, his eyes should never leave front side number four. He will dictate where the quarterback will go with the ball on 62-63. His eyes should, in other words, if you were the defense, the camera was the defense, and we're going to my right, we're going 62. My head would be turned to the right on a 45. I would be locked on front side number four while calling cadence. As I got the ball and came out, I'm still watching number four, front side number four. Now, why is he watching number four? That's his read. We make it very simple for the quarterback. He has one read. He is going to look at front side four. If front side four attacks the bubble or stretch route, then we're going to throw the gangster out in behind him. If he drops, or we're going to throw, if he drops, try to cover that curl of the gangster route, then we're going to throw the bubble route. If he blitzes, we have a blitz adjustment. The quarterback's seeing it. It's the only time he's going to see the blitz, probably the only time he's going to see it so clearly. Then the front side split end, or the one receiver, is also reading four for blitz. If four comes on blitz or shows a real hard blitz route, we have a blitz adjustment where we're now going to run a real quick inside post, and the quarterback's going to flick the football, and we take away a lot of that front side four blitz that way. Our blitz package, we have a couple different blitz packages, and they work real well. Now, if front side four sits there and he wants to play cat and mouse, we tell the quarterback to try and throw the ball to the curl. If he can see clear jersey, throw to curl. We think it's almost impossible for the four man to play cat and mouse if he just sits there, doesn't move from the snap. The quarterback's going to roll that whole time. He just sits there trying to play cat and mouse. Quarterback, go where it's the easiest throw. We try to look at the curl first. If that's not the easiest throw, hit the stretch or the bubble route. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the split end is reading front side four as well. If there's blitzes, we now have a blitz adjustment. The split end will yell blitz loud, turn his head inside quickly, hands up, and run a quick inside slant, expecting the ball almost immediately to his inside. Now, the line rules. Most importantly, the line plays an important role in this play, as they all plays, but front side tackle is going to block front side number two defender. Front side guard is responsible for front side number one, which is usually the linebacker, if we're talking a 50 front. Now, if that linebacker comes, we tell front side guard to attack him, to meet him force on force. Don't sit back on your haunches. Don't get bowled over. Don't let him run by you, but attack and protect that the B gap. If he drops to coverage or he loops outside at the snap of the ball, he's over the guard and he loops outside or he drops in coverage, turn back inside and what we call a spill technique, spill back and try to help the center if he needs help or continue to spill back getting depth and cut anybody trying to get to the quarterback in your backside pursuit. The center is responsible for front side number zero, man in the middle. If it's in nose, we're playing a 50 front, he's responsible for the nose. If we're playing a 40 front, he is responsible, and let's say there's no one over him. He's to step hard with his right foot if we're going 62. Step A gap, stick his hand up and jam. Nothing comes, turn back and use spill technique. Help anybody backside, cut off backside pursuit. The backside guard, his rule is the same as front side guard. You're responsible for backside number one.
he comes attacked, if he doesn't come, he drops or skates, then you are to turn back and help cut any backside pursuit, help on the backside, or what we call spill technique. And you'll see that on the board here in just a moment. The backside tackle, responsible for backside number two. Step hard to his inside, so we're going to get a quick inside penetration, and turn out on the backside number two. Now, I want to mention one thing on the front side number two receiver rules. First, on that hot route we were talking about earlier. When you come to the line, his eye should find the inside linebacker immediately when he comes to the line. Locate him and don't turn your head off him. If on the snap of the ball he blitzes, our front side halfback is going to yell, dog, as well as the front side guard yelling dog, so we get two dog calls, and we're going to run what some may call an arc route, a release route, a seam route, and the quarterback's going to want to hit him on the third step. Quarterback's looking out at four, he hears dog. The moment he hears double dog, he turns his head and will look for that halfback. If he's free, dump the football to him. This blitz package has really helped take away that inside blitz. Now, and you'll see that in the film, we've got a couple of those coming up for you. Many teams don't do it anymore because we have that in our package. Now, if that same linebacker bumps out before the ball is snapped, we're going to treat that like dog. I'm the guard, I see him bump out. He bumps past, he's going to bump out, we're going to treat that just like dog, and we feel we've got a mismatch with our skill quick outside our halfback on your linebacker. If he skates past him, even better. But we're going to try to hit that seam route right now and pop it in there for a big one. Okay, what I'd like to do at this time is just to draw on the board for you and go over. I'll go over 362 on the board with you, and then I'm going to just draw up several plays that we like to use out of 62, show them to you on the board, and then I'm going to go over our adjustments. And then after all of that, we have some live game footage of the 62-63 play being run. I think you'll really like it. If any time permits on the tape, I will put up a drill, a great drill that we run for this play. Obviously, we work an awful lot at it. Our kids are dedicated in the summer. They come about an hour and a half. We ask them 3-4 days a week to throw. They'll go up to the practice field, and they will throw on their own. We teach them the drill, and then we expect them up there. If you want to play quarterback, receiver, halfback for us, we expect you up there in the summer working 62 and waggle. So right now, let's take a look at 362. On the board at this time. Okay, here is 362 drawn up for you on the board. Notice we're in the 300 formation. Now, there's no motion in the, out of this. The halfback is going to just run the stretch route. He's running a, and he can't go flat here because of his position. We teach him that, that he's not up here, we can go flat. He's got to get here. But he's going to be in the same position he would be in if he was motioning from, say, if we were in a 100 look, or excuse me, a 500 look, and he motioned across, he'd be in the exact same position. Now, here is front side number one. He's running, and this really isn't drawing correctly, we're gonna try to get 5-2-7 and come back, getting his numbers back. We want the receiver to almost, if you were the quarterback, we like when he stops and pivots, we want his hands up and his numbers facing the quarterback, put his back to the defender. Make the defender come over your back if he's going to try and stop that pass. Now, and you'll see that in the film coming up. Our receivers do a great job. That our receiver coach, Coach Smith, does a great job teaching the 62 route, the gangster route. Here is our hot route, and if the inside linebacker, let me just draw that up for you. If this backer here, he tries to drop, right now we want to make a basketball move, and again, if here I was coming upfield,
And now here comes the linebacker from here. I'm going to come upfield. I'm going to turn my back to that linebacker. I'm going to give my hands up and my head back to the quarterback. I'm going to turn back to the quarterback, hands up, like I'm looking for the football. In reality, I'm boxing out just like a basketball player would. Now, we want to stop that backer right here from getting underneath the curl route. If this backer was to blitz, now this guard obviously is not going to turn back. He's going to attack him. Alright, he's going to attack front side number one. He is going to yell dog. We're going to get a dog here. And here you see the blitz or the hot route being stopped. The quarterback right here would stop, turn his head back, and pop the football to the halfback. And we've got him running down the seam. We got a couple of those when people did try to blitz. And we'll show you a couple of those. We hit for some big plays, a couple touchdowns, I think, on some live footage. And this has been a great play for us. We don't get a lot of this, I have to admit. We get more backside pressure because people know what we're going to do there. So oftentimes, we're going to get him to drop. And again, as I said, if before the snap, he skated out, he tried to move outside, they're going to bump everybody over and turn under. We're going to hit dog here because this backer is going to bump. And if he bumps too far, then I'll tell you, we're going to come right back with some 21 trap real quick. Because they got other backers over here. So he's only probably going to bump to the middle, maybe just to the A gap. He'll bump out. We'll call dog here. And he'll be on the outside of this halfback. And we'll throw it to the inside. And there's nobody there to get him. And again, we're where we want to be. So in either case, bumping out or blitzing is a dog read to us. If he drops in coverage, as we mentioned here, then we're going to run our hot box out route. Here is the fullback, as you can see, attacking three. We want to do a better job at this. We didn't do a bad job this year, but I felt our fullbacks oftentimes waited. For some reason, they got this idea they were like almost cup protecting and going to wait. We want to attack. I want this fullback to come and get three. If he can get him on the line, I think it's almost unstoppable then. And we're going to try to get his outside hip, get his hands down, and make a big hit on this one here. Okay? Look at this backside guard. Let's say this backer drops. He gets out of here. This backside guard checks and uses spill technique. So if we get a big rush, he's in position to push it back further, deeper, make it take the longer route to the quarterback. No quick, straight, direct route to the quarterback. That's the key. Here's the bubble route. Quarterback would be reading number four. Let's put number four out here for you. Let's just say we're playing a 50 front. We've got a strong safety to the two receiver field side. Again, if I didn't mention this earlier, you do want to run 62-63. To the field. You want a lot of room to operate. Stretch the defense. Now, let's say, for example, four snap of the ball, four is responsible and comes up to cover. Alright, so we can so four is no longer there because four is coming up, and you can see we got a good throwing lane into the gangster route. If four tries to sit and drop underneath that, we'll take this little route, and you'll see in here, it's a couple times, you only get a couple yards, but a lot of times we'll catch it, and he'll 5-6. We also have a call you'll be seeing, one of our adjustments. If we get a lot of this, we'll just call flip, and then just tell him, give him the ball just right now, tell the quarterback, don't worry about your reads, just throw the ball right here, get it to your back, and let him run. A little swing pass, get to a skilled athlete out here, one-on-one, one-on-none, he's running, which has been that's a good play. You'll see several of those coming up in the live game footage. So now, the other thing that could happen to us is, and let me get some of this out of here for you. Four sitting here, and here he comes creeping, and he's going to blitz. We're going to try to get him. Here he comes. Well, remember what I told you earlier, that this split end is reading him as well. As soon as he goes, he takes one step, yells blitz, and is on the quick slant, and we're going to throw. Quarterback sees the blitz coming, he's going to pull up, and we're going to throw the ball right in there behind him. Let him come hard, throw the ball past him. And again, we've taken away a lot of that because of this. We don't see that a lot. All right, and we have some other things we can do too if we want to get that. All right, that was 362. What I'd like to do now is just show you another way that we do this would be out of, for example, 562. Okay, we'll show it to you out of 562, put some formations up there. We'll show you how to run this play. I think you're going to love the video. It's a great football, one of the greatest plays in football today, especially high school football. And I hope you like it, hope you can use it. I hope you can adapt it somehow to your offense. If you're an I team, you can still do that. We do it out of I-900 sometimes, and we put this tailback back here, and we can motion him out and get him out there. We can motion step him up and get him out there, and you'll see a bunch of things on the field. We're not an I football team. I'm just saying you can do that. So, all right, let's take a look at 362. Look at 960 or 62 play. We just showed you 962. I think one of the things that we do well that really helps the 60 package is the adjustments we make off of it. We're going to show you several of those at this time, and we'll show you again in live game footage following this on the board. You'll see this in live action, and the adjustments we do here really make it hard, I believe, to defend this play. And the first one we're going to look at is our counter pass. By that, we're going to call 62 as some formation. We're going to call 62 counter pass. And we're going to make it look like we're going to run the gangster route to the right. But then we're going to bring it back to the other side. So let's look at that at this time.
Thank you. lid from these velvet rims and strap your hands across my engines. Together we could break this trap. We'll run till we drop. Baby, we'll never go back.
You've learned something today. I hope that we've been able to help you in some way. Again, I'd like to remind you that if you would like a copy of our playbook, it's $12. Please mail it to the address that was included in front of the video. You can see it's got a nice binding to it, a cover. It's very detailed, very thick, and probably about 90 pages. I said 80, 90 pages. And everything in there that you wanted or that you might want to know about, is there, so please send that in if you would like that. I'd like to thank all of you out there who purchased this video. I like you, purchase videos from Coach Rex Road. I also purchase anything on football I can get my hands on. I want to know as much as I can. I love the game. I think that those of us who are buying videotapes, those of us who are buying pamphlets and books, we're trying to get better at what we do. We're trying to help the young men we coach. If there's anything I can do to help you, please feel free to contact me at any time. If you think you have something you'd like to share with me, believe me, we're always looking and willing to learn. I guess I sort of feel like old Coach Woody Hayes, you say up here, that right near the end of his coaching career, he believed that he was just beginning to get an awareness of the game, he used to say. And he was always studying it and always working at it. And if a man of his magnitude, or a person like Bear Bryant, or Daryl Royal, any of the great college coaches that then and today, who work real hard in high school coaches, there are a great many of you out there who work hard and try to get better. And you do that by studying what other people do or trying to improve what you do. And that brings me to my last point, I guess. That's that I want to thank Coach Rex Road very much for the opportunity. His hard work and love for this game makes all this possible for myself and others to make videos, to purchase them from him, to have a ready access, a wealth of knowledge there. His handouts have been great for my staff, my younger coaches. Again, I just can't say how important I think getting young coaches involved and learning is, how much that helps your program. I think Coach Rexroad has a great service. I know you're taking advantage of it because you have this tape, but spread the word. Coach Rexroad does a great job here. Sometimes we don't say thank you enough. So Bobby, I thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I just can't tell you how thankful I am to know you. Last but not least, gentlemen, I'd like to wish all of you the very best in 1992. I hope your season turns out exactly the way you want it to. I know that you're going to be working hard and trying to improve your football team, but I give you this one bit of advice. I hope you use some boot and shoot, or the whole aspect of it. But it really doesn't matter what offense or defense you use. It matters what kind of kids you're helping to turn into young men. If you're doing that job, if you're first and foremost concerned about your young men, and you develop a great family, develop great character and pride in those young men first, then all the other stuff will fall in line for you. Yes, you have to get in the weight room. Yes, you have to be flexible. You sure better be a student today. And all those other things are vital and they are important. But teach that young man how to be a good, solid citizen. And you'll do more than you ever could win 100 football games. I know that may sound philosophical, but I believe it in my heart. I believe it to be true. And gentlemen, I think we're the last stronghold in America out there. I really believe that athletics is the last place that a young man can develop into a fine citizen, along with all the other things we do, the classroom and the field and the X and O's, everything else. But teach that young man to be a good person. Now, I thank you for your time. Again, if I can be of any assistance, please call me. Write to me. If you think you can help me, you think you have something I can use, let me know, please. And again, the very best of luck. God bless each and every one of you. Thank you so much.